Have you ever been playing an adventure game and suddenly lost control of your character because a cutscene starts, revealing the plot of the game through a cinematic where your character moves by itself? Or in a strategy game or map editor, have you had the option to undo a recent action? You've probably come across these situations many times, but have you ever wondered how they're coded? Is all that extra logic stuffed into the player class? In this video, I'll dive into a popular design pattern that's super handy for these scenarios, the command pattern. This design pattern lets us wrap a request as an object, offering a range of flexibilities and capabilities I will walk you through. For this, I have created this example in which we can control a character, making him move and attack. But I want that when he meets this wolf, I want an AI to take over, approach the wolf and attack. Think of this as a cutscene where we want the main character to act out a specific part of the story. This could be followed by some kind of dialogue or anything else. Now, you might think about cramming all this logic into the player class, but that's not ideal since it mixes responsibilities and further bloats one of the typically bigger classes in game development, which is the player class. This design pattern is eloquently detailed in a book called Game Programming Patterns. I highly recommend reading it, since it provides an exhaustive review of several design patterns in software development applied to video game development, with code examples and explanations and insights on each pattern. While it's available online, if you prefer physical copies as I do, I leave you a purchase link in the description. So, if you're interested in learning how to use this design pattern to achieve cleaner, tighter, and more efficient code, stay with me and let's see how to apply the command pattern in the Godot game engine. This is the example I created to demonstrate how to apply this pattern. We have this character who can move left and right and also attack. If we move to the right, we find this wolf. The idea is that as we approach, a fragment of the story jumps. We want the player to lose control of the character and the AI to direct it. The goal is to have the AI make the character approach the wolf and attack it. Obviously, this is a very simple and silly example, but I think it serves to demonstrate how to use the command pattern for this. The way I control this character is through the input class, all within the player script. The first thing we must create is the command class. This class defines an execute method in which it receives a player instance and an optional data argument. The goal of this method is to execute the appropriate action on the player. Note that at this point, we are coupling this command to the player, making it unable to be used by any other entity. I do this to keep this tutorial as simple as possible, but in a real case, instead of the player, you could receive a base class from which all your actors inherit. Now, we are going to create the command that will allow the player to move. We create the movement command class that inherits from command, and we set a params class where we are going to indicate the direction of movement using a float value. -1 for left, 0 for staying still, and 1 for moving to the right. In the execute method, what we have to do is call the appropriate player method to perform the move. I'm going to create a public method in the player class called move, where we will pass the input that the command tells us. I assign it to this variable called horizontal input, and the rest of the script already contains the necessary logic to use this value and move the character. Next, I can proceed to eliminate the point where I was obtaining the user input for the movement in this player class. We do the same for the attack command, but in this case it won't be necessary to create any parameters class since we don't need to know anything else. As before, I create this public method in player for the attack. In the case of my script, setting this variable isAttackToTrue is enough to trigger the attack. Now I find and eliminate the method I used before to obtain user input to attack. At this point, the player class no longer receives any input from the player. Now that we have the necessary commands created, we need something to issue them. I'm going to call this concept controller, although of course you can name it whatever you want. The idea is to have a base class, and extend it to allow the player to control the character, and another to make the AI control it. Let's start by creating the player controller base class. As you can see, this class maintains a reference to the player and instantiates each of the relevant commands. We make this class inherit from Node since we're going to have to interact with the game loop. Now, we're going to create the class in charge of receiving the player's input and making the character obey its orders. This is when you will see how everything takes shape. We create the human controller class with the following content. The idea will be to add this node as a child of the player. This way we can detect the user's input and execute the appropriate command. To do this, we will first have to create a container for this or any other controller. I'm going to call this node controller container. Now we will add the following logic to the player class. First, a reference to the newly added node so that its children can be manipulated. Second, this setController function will allow us to change the character's active controller. The first thing we must do is eliminate any active controller, and then instantiate the one we want to place. I'm going to create this variable to have a reference at all times of the active controller. We are going to set the human controller class that we just created as the default controller, so that the player can control the character as soon as the game opens. At this point, if everything has gone well, we should be able to run the game and control the main character as we did before. Next, we are going to create another class that inherits from player controller. But this time we will create a custom AI that will send the following commands. Now I'm going to write a bunch of logic in which I measure the time since this node exists to send commands to the character. This is just an example. Here we will use the appropriate logic for our use case. I recommend that you use more sophisticated mechanisms so that your AI is accurate. But I think you can already see the benefit that the command pattern brings us. The last step we have left is to decide at which point the AI will take control of the character. To do this, I'm going to create an Aria 2D that I will use to change the controller to the character. I'm going to place its collision shape over here, right before we meet the wolf. Now I'm going to add the following script to Aria 2D, where I'm going to connect the body and thread signal. To make this Aria able to detect the character, I have to configure the collisions layers correctly. Here, we only have to verify that the body is the player and set an AI controller through the setController method. If everything has gone well, I can open the game, move and attack freely, but when I approach the wolf, the AI takes control and performs the actions that I have programmed for it. At this point, I'm pressing the control keys, but I can't move the character anymore. I'm going to place this print so that you can see more clearly the point at which the AI takes control of the character. Of course, we can make the adjustments we want. For example, in AI controller, we can have control of the character returned to us after executing all the commands. We simply have to call the setController method with an instance of human controller. I'm also going to add a print so you can see the point at which control is returned to us. As you have seen, we have just managed to decouple the control of the character from the player class. Through this mechanism, we can obtain other benefits, not only being able to control the player in the cutscenes, but also, for example, that the player begins to control an enemy, or conversely, that an enemy begins to control the player. Furthermore, one of the most widespread uses of this pattern is to be able to redo actions. If you think about it, we're encapsulating each action in a command object, so we could store all of these objects and then be able to go back and redo actions already performed. If you're interested in me doing a tutorial on how to apply the command pattern for an undo system, let me know in the comments. I hope you found this tutorial useful and educational. If that is the case, please leave me a like and consider subscribing for more content like this. I hope you have a nice rest of your day. Goodbye.